So right now we are in a tropical hardwood hammock surrounded by lots of gumbo limbos, oaks, false mastics, cabbage palms. There's even some saw palmettos out here. It's actually really awesome to see the diversity that you get in these tropical hammocks here. The robust canopy above us provides shade for the tropical understory that we see here in front of us. And as you can hear, it's full of life. Today, we're really talking about how we connect our intercoastal waterways and our tropical hammocks. This is kind of what's on the interior, and as you get to the exterior, in some parts of the interior, we're gonna be running into mangrove ecosystems. Very exciting stuff. So we have made it out of the tropical hammock and now we're out to the estuary here where we're surrounded by three different species of mangroves that we're gonna go through today. We have our red mangroves, our whites, and our blacks. Right beside me here is a red mangrove. Generally, red mangroves are found furthest out in the water, and then you have your black mangroves, which is right behind it, kind of secondary, and then normally you have your white mangroves, which are kind of further up, and right behind me over here, we actually have two white mangroves that are actually in a little bit of that higher zonation. So this is kind of your natural trend that you're going to see here along mangrove shorelines. Although you will find white mangroves, black mangroves, and red mangroves kind of interspersed all throughout the same zones in a lot of shorelines here in Palm Beach County, that we notice that happening a lot. But generally, you're gonna see your reds, your blacks, your whites, and then your buttonwoods are also gonna be found near or at the same elevation as your white mangroves. And they're all characterized a little bit differently as far as how they deal with salt. Black mangroves are your extruders, where they're extruding salt through the base of their leaf, and your red mangroves being excluders, where they're actually holding that salt out at the root, giving it its red color. Those fibers within it are actually getting woven tighter and tighter together as they are introduced to more salt, giving them that red color that classifies a red mangrove. So it just kind of shows you how different mangroves deal with salt differently and how all of them grow in the same areas. Right here, we actually have a red and a black mangrove growing together. This is common to see them working together to stabilize shorelines, as black mangroves have more of those running roots that are really surface oriented and red mangroves get deeper. Red mangroves have what we call prop roots or drop roots. When the drop roots tend to come out on the above canopy branches and come straight down in the water, where your prop roots are what we see here. Those prop roots, as long as they're above water, have lenticels on them, and that's how they aid in getting oxygen and gas exchange to their roots. So as long as these trees are above water, they're breathing too, man. So in my hand here, we have oysters. Red mangrove roots specifically allow for oysters and other fouling organisms to attach to their roots. We have some barnacles that will grow on red mangroves, sponges, oysters, anything that can really grab a hold of them. You'll see snails as well that kind of attach to these roots. These will actually help to filter water. Well, they say that one oyster can filter up to 50 gallons of water per day. Right here we have a black mangrove, and they're characterized by a silver underside on their leaf. This is also where those, you'll actually find those salt crystals. You can actually go ahead and lick the back of a black mangrove leaf and taste the salt that's on them. So they're letting it directly through the pores on the base of the leaf. And also that silver indicator is how you can tell from a long distance away what type of mangrove it is. Whereas to the right of me here, we have our white mangrove, The white mangroves have a very rounded leaf. They don't come to a sharp point like our red mangroves will, and even our black mangroves are a little bit more elongated and skinnier in shape. So these are characterized, they're pretty much the same color on the top and the bottom of the leaf, a little lighter on the bottom, I guess. And they're classified by having a red stalk and two nectaries at the base of the leaf here. And these nectaries are used in secreting oils and also with extra substances that they come in contact with. Unique root adaptations that the black mangrove has are these snorkel-like features that we call pneumatophores that come out of the water at the high tide, just like you see here, that are allowing and aiding the gas exchange for the root systems for these. So roots on mangroves, they all need to breathe, right? And these particular trees breathe through these adaptations that provide kind of like what a snorkel would be for us as a human. White mangroves do not have really any unique adaptations for their root systems. They grow most like your normal terrestrial trees would, where it's just this main stalk here and branches that come out. They breathe through the trunk of the tree. So as long as it's above water, they're getting oxygen to the roots. The black mangrove, just like the red mangrove, gets its name from the coloration on its bark. As these trees become more mature, they actually get this black tone that starts to cover them up. And that's really where they originally got characterized as a black mangrove, is because of their color, and the same with the reds. And you know, you could probably make a reference that the white mangroves have a little bit of a white trunk too. So the color of the trunk of the tree actually played a role in naming the mangroves that we have here in Florida. So just for comparison, we pulled three different types of leaves here just to show you guys kind of side by side what they look like. So as you can see, your red mangrove leaves tend to be larger and comes to that point. You have your black mangrove leaves, which tend to be smaller and are more elongated and have that silver backside to them. And then you have your white mangroves, which are the most rounded and kind of a mix between the red and the black as far as their shape, and their size is usually in between the red and the black. And if you take the black mangrove and you lick it, it's a little bit salty. So as you can see along the shoreline here, we actually have a buttonwood as well as black mangroves, red mangroves, and white mangroves all coexisting together. Buttonwoods are actually an associate mangrove, although we believe they should be probably classified as a mangrove, as their ability to actually deal and tolerate with salt. It's growing at the same elevations as our black and our red mangroves and whites. So it's, to us, it makes sense that it would be actually classified as a mangrove because of its ability to tolerate and deal with salt. They have little buttons as seeds. So these seeds are how you're gonna characterize a buttonwood when it's flowering, and also give the buttonwood its name. Mangroves are amazing rookeries for our birds, right? And as you can see above me here, there's a giant canopy above my head. And because of that, it allows for a lot of room for birds to come in and land, and also to make nests in these mangroves. These mangrove islands, these mangrove ecosystems, birds love them because they're out in the middle. There's not a lot of predators. And because of that, they'll come onto mangrove islands and mangrove shorelines and actually have their nests, lay their eggs, and raise their young. And also, you gotta think about the availability of food source. When you are a bird and you need to feed your chicks, your food source is right here, right? And that's also another key reason why birds love mangroves and they love rookeries, is because right in front of their very own nest could be fish that they can use to feed their baby chicks. We're out here at Tarpon Cove doing our 2-week recap. We kind of picked a windy day, but we wanted to just come out here and see what the mangroves look like. As you can see behind me here, we have a lot of mangroves that are still standing from a hurricane after being planted only a week prior, which is pretty amazing. We also have a couple that got knocked down from the storm, that we're gonna replant today. The good thing is that the root balls are still intact. They look healthy, and they got a little bit of wind damage that you can see in the tips of the mangroves, but overall, these guys should make it. We're gonna plant this one back down into the water today and reseed it back in its home. Overall, happy to see green tops on our mangroves after a hurricane, and looking forward to seeing these mangroves grow up. So we started this project with Palm Beach County ERM a few years ago, and we started planting this island in particular in 2020. It's now 2022, almost 2023. This island is about 2.5 years old, right? And to be able to see growth like this is tangible growth, not only for this island, for these mangroves, but actually for our business as a whole. These mangroves are a representation of who we are at MANG, how we've grown over the years, and how these projects are really special to our hearts and special to the places that we grew up. We grew up right down the road here, less than 5 miles up southern. So we used to come and fish this area quite a lot as kids, and there wasn't a lot around this area, right? There wasn't a lot of habitat, a lot of structure. And now with the introduction of these islands, we can actually come and we can fish these areas and actually catch some fish, right? We haven't done it a lot. We've heard about people that are actually catching a lot of fish around these islands and just seeing the life come in. I mean, there's more bird life than there's ever been. There's more fish life than there's ever been. And ultimately, this is a representation of our company and the hard work and dedication that we've put in over the years. And really, it's just, for me, one of those things that is priceless, right? All the days that we spent not going out and fishing, all the days that we spent in the office working hard to make this dream come true, and seeing the reality of what it actually looks like, whereas we just started by just growing mangroves in our mom's backyard, and now we have mangroves that are planted on an island in our lagoon. Years later, seeing them grow up and actually putting prop roots out and stretching out for new life, I mean, you can't put dollar signs on that. All the sacrifice, all the hard work. To be able to actually put your dreams on the table and actually see them come true is an amazing feeling. And one thing that we like to teach our youth is that you can create something that gives back and is successful and is profitable and ultimately feeds into what you love. And what we love is our fisheries, our communities, and how our ecosystems give back to them all.